Thank you, Mr. Daoud. I want to say something, particularly concerning the issue of water, and I see the panel talking about right to organize. There's been some kind of historical breakdown in understanding of the issue of protest. Marches, nonviolent marches, became effective relative to an event that took place in the 1700s of the French Revolution. The French Revolution starts off as nonviolent marches. Unless we get bread, land, food, unless we get our rights, we're going to keep marching. They didn't get it, so it escalated. Because power is the ability to deliver consequences if your demands are not met. There was no power simply in marching. Because they started out marching, they didn't get what they wanted, they organized, and eventually they cut off the head of the king and the queen of France. They got what they wanted. Now, in the African American context, we look at the nonviolent civil rights movement. We see that they were marching in the South, but we don't see that the context was, during slavery they had laws that no more than 3 to 5 black people could congregate unless there was a white person present. So to march, and they still had these laws in the South that you could not congregate. So to have a march in Selma, Alabama, or Vicksburg, Mississippi, or Bogalusa, Alabama, anywhere, that disrupted the whole city. It disrupted the energy of the whole town because, first of all, it was illegal. So when they had these marches, they had a great deal of effectiveness. We saw in the media how these marches were attacked and all that. Martin Luther King, and let me say, people assassinated Dr. King in 1963 on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. He lived 5 more years. He had much more than a dream, but nobody talks about his plan. Dr. King said that nonviolent demonstrations are ineffective in the North. He came to Chicago in 1966, was hit on the head with rocks, and driven out of the city. He said that a nonviolent demonstration in the South disrupted the whole town. He said, but the energy in a large city in the North is so great that nothing is disrupted by a nonviolent demonstration. So he comes up with another plan called the Poor People's Campaign, which he said on April the 10th, 1968, in the thousands, we're going to go to Washington, D.C. We're going to engage in nonviolent civil disobedience. We're going to sit in front of the White House, Congress, and the Pentagon, and let nothing in and nothing out unless they deal with issues of poverty and war in America. He said, this is what we're going to do, April the 10th, 1968. J. Edgar Hoover said that was a revolutionary act. Dr. King was assassinated exactly 7 days before that. Now, after his assassination, some of us are old enough to remember that people went to Washington, D.C. Did they do any of the things that Dr. King said? Have they ever done any of these people who always talk about they love Dr. King, have they, since he was dead, gone to Washington, D.C. and done any of the things Dr. King said to them? They have done none of them. None of them whatsoever. And similarly now, in the North, nonviolent demonstrations for water or for whatever will not be effective unless we are able to deliver consequences when your demands are not met. We can see that Dr. King had consequences, he said. He's going to deliver. Black Panther Party, when we were here in the city, we had consequences we're going to deliver. Others have had consequences we're going to deliver. We ask, why is it that all of us are right? So many people have a right to water. Why is it that they don't get water? Why are they putting tens of thousands of dollars in water bills on poor people who can't afford to pay them? And everybody knows you're right. Everybody's seen you demonstrate. Everybody's seen you in the media. But nothing changes. Why? Because you have no consequences you can't deliver when your demands are not met. That was what the Black Power movement was about. Black power was the ability to have power, which means delivering consequences when your demands are not met.